إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. إنه من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح بالأمة فكشف الغمة. فاللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك وأنعم على حبيبنا ورسولنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بهديه وصار على نهجه إلى يوم القيامة. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر، آمين يا رب العالمين. My dear respected brothers and sisters and elders, we start by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Allah for who He is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is worthy of praise whether we praise Him or not. He is worthy of praise whether we believe in Him or not. He is worthy of praise whether we start deciding or we decided to praise Him or not. So it's our duty to always praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first and foremost for who He is. And we praise Him for allowing us to attend one more Jum'ah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who say or hear this speech and follow the best of it. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Our topic inshaAllah ta'ala in the next few minutes that we have together around one of the or the most amazing person to walk on the face of this earth. And that's the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when we're talking about the Prophet, we can spend hours and days and weeks and months to talk about him. But today, inshallah, I wanted to focus on one aspect, which is the love that he had for us. And the love that he had specifically for young people. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had so much love for those around him and for those that came after him that we will never fully understand. And he had mercy and care and so much compassion for them that the moment we learn about it increases our love for us just a tiny bit. So the goal inshallah for the khutbah today is not for us to have a lot of action items, just for us to love and appreciate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just one tiny bit. That's the goal for the khutbah inshallah. Imam al-Tabarani mentions in his book that a man by the name of Al-Khawwat ibn al-Jubayr, or Khawwat ibn al-Jubayr, a young man, one time he goes on a trip with the Prophet ﷺ. And it was the habit of the Prophet, whenever he goes on a trip, he will take some people with him. He will never go alone. And he spends that time to get to know them better, get to spend time with them and teach them. And this was from his hadi and his guidance, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now it's a young man. So he says, Khawwat narrates that story. He says that at night time, the Prophet was sleeping in his tent, I was sleeping in my tent. I heard some girls talk outside. So he says, I liked what they were talking about. So I looked into my stuff and I put my best clothes on and I went outside to hang out with them. Young man, it's understood. And the Prophet is sleeping. So he says, I went and they were talking and I liked what they were talking about, so I started hanging out with them. And all of a sudden, the Prophet wakes up to make wudu in the middle of the night. And he was not expecting that. So the Prophet sees him and he says, Khawwat, what are you doing? What are you doing, man? So he says, I got so nervous, I didn't know what to say. The Prophet ﷺ saw me in the middle of these girls in the middle of the night. What is the Prophet thinking? So I went like, I'm looking for my camel. Oh, Messenger of Allah, I lost my camel. I'm looking for my camel. So the Prophet says, oh, your camel. Okay. Well, you better get back to your tent. So he goes back and he says, every time the Prophet ﷺ sees me, and again, they're on a trip together, so they're together all the time. He says, so Khawwat, how's your camel? And he says, I hated it. I was so shy and embarrassed of getting that question from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he says, I decided to take my camel and go back to Medina. I'm like, I can't dig this anymore. Because he was embarrassed. He knew he was doing something wrong. The Prophet ﷺ also knew that he was doing something wrong. But look at how the Prophet dealt with the situation. He knows it's a young man. So it's kind of understood. So he says, I went back to Medina and I would avoid going to the masjid. Just so I don't have to face the Messenger ﷺ. He says, because I know every time I see him, he's going to ask me, how's your camel? So he says, until one time, اشتقت إلى المسجد. I missed the masjid so much, I wanted to go. So he says, فذهبت وقت الضحى. I went around the time of duha when there's not a lot of people in the masjid. So he says, I purposely went to at a time when there's not a lot of people there. So he says, I went and nobody, alhamdulillah, was in the masjid and I wanted to pray. So I started praying. And he says, as I was praying, the messenger comes from his house. Remember, the messenger of the Prophet is attached to his house. And the door, you open the door of the Prophet's house, he's inside the masjid. And everybody knows when you open the door, it's the Prophet. Like nobody's gonna come from this door other than the messenger. So he says, the messenger came inside the masjid. I'm like, oh man, he's gonna ask me again. And remember, he hasn't been to the masjid for so long, and the Prophet would also know who is not at the masjid. So the Prophet prayed two quick rak'ahs and then he sat down waiting for him. And he says, I prolonged my prayers hoping that the Prophet would leave. Right? Because usually the Prophet would enter, he would pray to, you know, to tahiyyat al-masjid, he would greet the host, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then he would go on his business. So he says, the messenger didn't leave. He stayed there. So I start praying longer and longer, like reading longer surahs, staying long in my sujood, and was just hoping so he can leave, so he doesn't have to face me. So the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam realized that khawat was prolonging on purpose. So he says, أطل يا عبد يا أبا عبد الله ما شئت فلن أنصرف حتى تنتهي. He says, أبو أبا عبد الله, that was his kunya, prolong your prayers as you will. I'm not leaving until you finish. We have some business to talk about. So he says, okay, fine. So I finished my prayers and then I went to the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he goes, so how's your camel? Again. So Khawad says, Wallahi ya Rasulullah, ma sharadat naqati mundu an aslamt. O messenger of Allah, my camel never got lost since I became Muslim. This was just an excuse. And then he tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he tells him, you know, I was just, you know, I'm a young man with some girls. I just wanted to hang out. I didn't know you're going to wake up. So the Prophet ﷺ, this is the point of the story. The Prophet ﷺ then says, Allahumma arham Khawat, Allahumma arham Khawat. Oh Allah, have mercy on Khawat. Oh Allah, have mercy on Khawat. Oh Allah, have mercy on Khawat. And then he says, Wallahi, I never returned back to what I was doing before. The reason I'm starting with this story is because when you understand and you look how the Prophet ﷺ, the love that he had for his people, it's phenomenal. And the mercy, he understands it's a young man. He knows what young people go through. So he didn't scold him, he wasn't harsh with him. He dealt with him in the best way possible. And he made dua for him, and the young man understood. And also you learn that these young people knew what they were doing wrong. He knows that he's doing something wrong, but yet he didn't know how to deal with it. And the Prophet just simply made dua for him. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the brothers and sisters in the Quran, he says, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِدْتُمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that Allah sent a messenger from amongst you. Ibn Ashur in his tafsir, he says that it's referring to the people of Mecca at the time, to the Arabs at the time. But other Mufassirin says that it's talking to all of humanity. That the messenger is not some strange man that none of us can relate to. Actually, we, all of us, can relate to the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you're a father, you can learn from the messenger. If you're a son, you can learn from the messenger. If you're a husband, if you're a wife, if you're a friend, if you are a boss, if you're a businessman, if you're a doctor, if you're an imam, if you're a student of knowledge, whatever role you play in your life, the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam can provide us guidance and techniques and how to live our life. And one of the best things that he did was just loving us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He had so much love for this ummah that we can never imagine. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in that verse, حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْهِ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِدْتُمْ. He never wants to see you go through hardships. Never wants you to go through hardship. And his sunnah does exactly that. In a hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, لَوْلَا أَنَا شُقَّ عَلَى أُمَّتِي لَأَمَرْتُهُمْ بِالْوُضُوءِ عِنْدَ كُلِّ صَلَاةِ. Because I didn't want to make it hard for my ummah, I would have commanded them to make wudu before every salah. Now to us today, it might not be a big of a deal. But I'll tell you something. For those that work in corporate America, or in companies that there's a lot of non-Muslims around, making wudu is pretty uncomfortable. Now you could be one of those who actually take their feet and put it in the sink and you make wudu, and some of us do that. But some of us will be just okay, you know, just wipe on the socks. But how many times have you actually sat there, you make wudu, you're washing your face and you're washing your arms, and then like a VP walks in just to use the bathroom, and you're like, somebody's gonna ask you, what are you doing? Are you like that thing in the middle of the day at work? So some of us feel pretty uncomfortable. Azizun alayhi ma anittum, even the small little things. Now we have to make wudu before every salah. But a lot of us today just make one wudu and pray dhuhr, asr, maghrib with it. Right or not? Sometimes people cannot make wudu all the time because the water is cold. Now alhamdulillah we have hot water. Now think about other people on the other side of the world that they don't have hot water. Sometimes it's pretty convenient to make one wudu and pray several prayers with it. The rest of the hadith, the Prophet in the second part of the hadith, he says, وَلَوْلَا أَنَا شُقْ عَلَى أُمَّتِي لَأَمَرْتُهُمْ بِالسِّوَاكِ عِنَّ كُلِّ صَلَاةِ. I would have commanded my people to use the siwak before every prayer. But he didn't want to make it hard for us. How many of us walk around with a siwak today? Not a lot. But that's because he cared. Small little thing. Right? Listen to this hadith. If you leave with nothing from the khutbah today, you leave with this hadith. One time, the Messenger and Aisha radiallahu anha narrates this hadith, and it's mentioned by Ibn Hibban, and Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah said it's an authentic narration. So Aisha radiallahu anha says, رأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وكان طيب النفس. One time they were hanging out together, and she says كان طيب النفس, which basically means he was in a good mood. So I saw the Messenger, and the Messenger was in a good mood. فقلت له ادعوا لي الله يا رسول الله. I said to him, O Messenger of Allah, make du'a for me. So the Prophet ﷺ raised his hands, and again it was from his habit to always raise his hands whenever he'll make du'a. So he says, and listen to this du'a carefully. He says, اللهم اغفر لعائشة ما قدمت وما أخرت وما أصرت وما أعلنت. O Allah, forgive Aisha's sins, the past and the future, and those sins that are shown and those sins that are hidden. Aisha says, I became so happy. I became so happy. فَضَحَكْتُ حَتَّى سَقَتَتْ رَأْسِي فِي حِجْرِي. Which was an expression, and if you want to translate it, I found the best translation to be rolling on the floor laughing. And it's a common thing that people use today. For some of the younger guys know what I'm talking about. So the Aisha says, I was so happy with the Prophet's du'a. To the point that my head fell into the, you know, into my like my lap. And she was just expressing how happy she was with the Messenger's du'a, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he says, you know, أَصَرَّكِ دُعَائِ. Did that du'a make you really that happy? She says, وَكَيْفَ لَا يُسْرُّ دُعَاكِ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. Of course, you my husband, and you're the Prophet. And your du'a is accepted. How can I not be happy with your du'a? Of course I'm happy. Again, the du'a is, O Allah, forgive Aisha's sins, the past and the future. And forgive those sins that are shown and those that are hidden. That's the du'a. So he says, and that's the kicker. And that's what we really leave with today. He's like, Wallahi, inni la'adhu bihadha du'a ummati inda kulli salat. He says, Wallahi, I swear by Allah, I make that same du'a for my ummah in every single salah. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the Prophet ﷺ living his entire life making dua for you and your family and for all of us? حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ. Allah said it. Allah says He cares for you so much. He cares for your akhirah. He cares for your dunya. His sunnah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to us to bring ease. Some of the ulama, he even says, if you're going through some tough time before a presentation, if you're nervous, before an interview, if you have some nervousness inside of you and you're a little agitated, say the salawat. They'll make you feel better. And those that haven't tried it, try it, give it a shot. You'll see exactly what I'm talking about. Even remembering him brings ease to our hearts of Allah. Allah said it. Azizun alayhi ma anittum harisun alaykum. He cares for you. He cares for your dunya, he cares for your akhirah. He wants to make sure you live a good life. He wants to make sure that you are happy with your family. He gave you guidance so you know how to deal with your family and your friends and everybody around you. One time Anas ibn Malik says, we were walking with the Prophet ﷺ and he says, اشتقت لإخواني. I miss my brothers. And في رواية أخرى in another verse he says, وددت لو رأيت إخواني. I wish I see my brothers. And this mentioned Muslim Imam Ahmad. So Anas ibn Malik says, aren't we your brothers, O Messenger of Allah? I thought we're your brothers. He says, no, أنتم أصحابي. You're my companions. ولكن إخواني قوم يأتون بعدي يؤمنون بي ولم يروني. But my people, my brothers are those who comes after me. They believe in me, but they never see me. The Prophet misses you. The Prophet ﷺ wants to see you. Do you really want to see him? What happens if you see him today? He misses us, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He would spend his time making dua for us. Make sure that we are ready for the Day of Judgment. We know so many narrations, specifically about the Day of Judgment. The Prophet ﷺ would be standing there at this end of the Sirat, waiting for everybody to pass, and he's going to say, Allahumma sallim, Allahumma sallim. He's going to make sure that every single person makes it into Jannah safely, and then he will go, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There is one narration I'll mention, inshallah, in the second part of the khutbah. قُلْ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ الْعَظِيمَ وَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَّحِيمٌ. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, wa la adwan illa ala al-zalameen, wa la aqibatul muttaqeen, Allahumma salli wa sallam, wa barik wa na'am, ala habibina wa rasulina Muhammadin sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, wa ala alihi wa sallam, wa ala nahjihi ila yawm al-qiyamah. So it was out of the habit of the Prophet ﷺ that he would pray Qiyam al-Layl every single night. It was an obligation for him. It wasn't an option, it was an obligation for him to pray every single night. This hadith mentions Sahih Muslim. The Prophet ﷺ was reported that he would recite a verse at the end of Surah Al-Ma'idah. إِن تُعَذِّبُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. This is a verse that Jesus, Isa alayhi salam, peace be upon him, would recite and would make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah records it in the Quran. Quick translation is that, oh Allah, if you punish them, and Jesus is talking about that, about his people, right? Oh Allah, if you punish them, they are your servants. Oh Allah, if you punish them, they are your servants. But if you forgive them, and if you forgive their sins, then you are Al-Aziz, you are the old one glorified, and Al-Hakim, you are all wise. So Isa alayhi salam, again remember, a lot of people did not follow him. So he would always make that dua. So the Prophet ﷺ knows what went down with the people of Isa. He knows that a lot of them didn't follow him, they worshipped him later in their life. So the Prophet ﷺ would make this dua, and he would pray the night prayers with that verse. And he would cry so much. He would cry so much. And just recite this one verse, keeps repeating it over and over and over again. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala one time sends down Jibreel. And he tells him, Sal Muhammad ma yukik. And this mentions Sahih Muslim, it's an authentic narration. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down Jibreel to ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, why are you crying? Now Allah knows, right? Allah knows everything. What does he have to, why does he have to ask Jibreel to ask the Prophet? So we can learn. Because we will never know why the Prophet was crying if that conversation didn't take place, right? So the conversation took place and we know why the Prophet was crying today because of Allah sending down Jibreel. So Allah sent down Jibreel and he said, ask Muhammad, why is he crying? Remember, this is the entire night prayers. So Jibreel comes down to the Prophet ﷺ and says, why are you crying? He says, Ummati, Ummati. My people. I cry for my people. He He's crying for you and I. The whole night. He's crying so we don't end up being like other nations. He's crying so we can all go to Jannah. He's spending his night for you and I, brothers and sisters, so we can have a good akhirah. حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِدْتُمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِدْتُمْ حَرِيصٌ. He cares for you. Allah said it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He cares for you. So Jibreel goes up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he tells him, oh Allah, he's crying for his people. And look at this next part. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, tell Muhammad, إِنَّا سَنُضِيكَ فِي أُمَّتِكَ. And the translation of that is phenomenal. Right? Because he's crying for us, right? The Prophet is crying for you and I. So we can have a good akhirah. So we can all go to Jannah and we can leave hellfire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't tell him, we'll take care of your ummah, don't worry about them. No, he says, إِنَّا سَنُضِيكَ فِي أُمَّتِكَ. We are going to take care of your ummah until you're pleased. Not until they're pleased, but until you're pleased. Think about this for a second. We are going to go to Jannah, so the Prophet is pleased, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because of his dua. And in another riwayat, Muslim Imam Ahmad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَنُدْخِلُ الْجَنَّةَ مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. That anybody who just says لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, just لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, doesn't matter how many sins you have, how many mistakes you made, it doesn't matter how long you've been a Muslim, it doesn't matter. Just say la ilaha illallah, you will enter Jannah. Because of the Prophet's dua. That's how much he loved for you. So that's how much love he had for you and I. Now the question comes in. Because you know, we're talking about all these things, and the question is, how much do we know about him? And how much do we try to live by his sunnah? How much do we love him? Simply, and you'll get to love someone by getting to learn about them. And the more you know about somebody, the more you love them. The more you know about somebody, the more you love them. Because verily, with no doubt, he had so much love for us. So much love. For all of us. For those that lived around him and for those that came after him. And Allah says it, and I'll repeat the verse again. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِدْتُمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. What's the difference between Ra'uf and Rahim? First, Ibn Ashur in his book, in his tafsir, he says that the only messenger who gets the two attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ra'uf and Rahim. The only messenger. Other messengers were giving attributes. But the only one that gets two from the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now what's the difference between Ra'uf and Rahim? Because I think that wraps up the khutbah beautifully, inshallah. Ra'uf is somebody who helps you to prevent anything that harms you. As-sa'yu fi saddi ad-darr. It's somebody who works really hard so you don't get harmed. That's somebody who's Ra'uf to you. And the Messenger is Ra'uf to us. And Rahim, السعي في جلب النفع, which is putting an effort, working really hard to bring benefit. And that's our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now our job is to just learn a little bit about him. And I promise you, brothers and sisters, no one learns about the Prophet except that they just fall so deeply in love with him. So deeply in love with him. And those that learn a little bit, they want to know more and more and more. And that's it. That's the message for today. We love the Messenger of Allah. Well, first, he loves us. At least we establish that. Now, our job is, how much do I love him? I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who truly love the Messenger. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us opportunities to learn about him. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who follow his sunnah as much as they can. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for what we've done and help us in the future so we can get closer to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa yassir lahumma ala al-haqqi aqdamana wa ansurna ala al-qawm al-kafirin. Allahumma tub alayna linatub. Allahumma tub alayna linatub. وطهرنا من الخطايا والذنوب واستر يا رب لنا جميع العورات والعيوب. اللهم لا تجعل هذه الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا.
اللهم اجعل الجنة هي دارنا يا رب العالمين. عباد الله رحمكم الله، اتقوا الله. يقول المولى عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك وانعم على حبيبنا ورسولنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. وأخر الصلاة.